All right, in this video, let's now talk about AlexNet trained on Cypher 10. So just to recap how AlexNet looks like, it's this architecture where we have as input 96 channels, then 256 going from 96. So the input images, first of all, are 224 times 224 times 3. After the first convolution, it's 96 channels. Then 256 channels, 386, I think there should be 384, like I mentioned, I think this was a typo. Then another 384, 256, and then these fully connected layers. And you can see these fully connected layers are really huge. So there's 4096, 4096, and then 1000 class labels. I shortened the first layer a little bit from 96 to 64, but overall I try to keep the same architecture that I implemented. Notice that we are not training it on ImageNet, we are training it only on Cypher 10 images, which are smaller. So in that way, I made some small adjustments to account for the smaller size of the input images. So here, everything should be the same as before. I'm actually not rerunning this now because this might take a while. I will show you at the end how long it took to train this architecture. So I ran this on a GPU also. So first of all, let me only go through the changes that are different from the LINET that I showed you before. One change is that we now have Cypher 10 images instead of MNIST images. So what I'm doing here also is I'm making the Cypher 10 images larger than they really are. So Cypher 10 is 32 times 32, but I'm making them larger, like 70 times 70, because otherwise I get problems with the dimensions. Because otherwise, we go back to the overview here. Otherwise, here at this point, the height and width will be too small, essentially. They will be non-existent, basically. So in that way, I have to resize the input images to make this network architecture work on Cypher 10. And what I'm doing is also to make the network a little bit more robust towards overfitting. What I'm doing is I'm doing a random crop. So I'm randomly cropping a 64 by 64 region from the 70 times 70 input that's during training, and every time it will be a different random crop. The regular to tensor thing. And then here I'm normalizing the channels, the color channels, to be centered, the pixels to be centered at zero. You could technically also compute the standard deviation and mean from the actual image data, but here what I'm doing is I'm just normalizing them in a very simple way, that the pixels are centered at zero and have are in the range between -1 and 1. That is the same as I did with MNIST before, but now I have three color channels, so that's why I'm doing it like this. If I just go back to my MNIST one, I only had one color channel, so I only had 0.5 here. All right, notice that I'm only doing this random crop for the training. I don't want any randomness when I apply my model to, let's say, new data during prediction, and validation and test data are mimicking new data, because I use that data to evaluate how well my model might perform on new data. And it wouldn't make sense to have some random cropping for new data. If you have, let's say, a customer, let's say at the airport, and you want to do face recognition to see whether the person at the airport is the same as on the passport or something like that, you don't want to just do random crops and predictions. You just want to do center crop. So the random crop is just to make the model more robust towards small perturbations. So here we use then the center crop instead of this random crop. The rest is all the same as before. I have my images, my batches are 256 in size, three color channels, 64 pixels high and 64 pixels wide. And I also have 10 classes. Here's the AlexNet architecture now. So you can maybe highlight the blocks. So this is one convolutional block. Then there's another one, just separating them out here. So these are the convolutional blocks. Here I only have max pooling, essentially. What I did was not ideal. I should have done it like this. Max pooling, conf2d, relu, max pooling. Okay. Notice here is no pooling in between. So yeah, just yeah, separated them into blocks. Can't see it here. Might be yeah, might be visible here. So you can see max pooling, max pooling, max pooling, but no pooling here. So try to implement that here. So that is how the AlexNet looks like. That is now the feature extractor part. So this whole part here is the feature extractor part. So I call it again features. So it's essentially that part up to here. And then the right side here is the multi-layer perceptron part. So here I call it again classifier. I also have an adaptive average pooling here. So what that will do is it will take whatever size that is, whatever size comes out of here, and pools it such by averaging such that the output feature mat will be 6x6. So in that way I can rely on that what comes in here in the linear is 256 times 6 times 6, because here I know that the number of channels that comes out of here is 256. So if I go back here, that's 256. And I know the size here is 6x6. That I'm saying it by average pooling. So if I give it larger images, if I give it images that are, I don't know, 150 times 150, it will also work the same way. I don't have to adjust my code. However, if I have images that are smaller than whatever I have as input, like the original Cypher 10, this will not work because at this stage we may have a 3x3 or something like that, and this doesn't upscale. It only downscales, but it doesn't upscale. So what I'm saying is if I would change it to 30 times 30, everything, we'll have to also change that to something like smaller than 30, but you get the idea. If this is smaller than 70 times 70, this will fail because what comes out of here is not 6x6, it might be 3x3, for instance. So adaptive average pooling will downsize something to a common size, and this will allow me then also to receive larger inputs. So in that way, the architecture is not so picky towards the exact resolution if I wanted to train it, say, on a different data set. Okay, so here that's my fully connected part. So I'm using Dropout in between. Did they use Dropout actually, or did I? I think I just added it because I had the overfitting. Yeah, I think so. I don't think they had it in the paper, but I would have to double check. I can't see it here. I would have to double check in the paper. But I'm pretty sure that's something I did because I was having massive issues with overfitting. I will show you next. All right, so here we have the features. Then we have this average pooling that brings everything down to 6x6. And then here, this is my fully connected one. I could have used flattening, actually. Could have used the flatten. But well, I didn't. I think the flatten is also relatively new, so I sometimes forget to use it because it's just recently added. And then I'm calling my classifier, which gives me my predictions. And that is, then here, everything is the same as before. I'm using, again, the same SGD with momentum, learning rate scheduler, same thing. But now it takes much longer to train. So it took, I was running it for 200 epochs, and it took a long time. Took approximately, 3 hours almost. And what was also interesting is, so usually what I do is when I train a network, I take a look at this output here. So that's maybe also as a tip for your homework 3. When you train the network, you want to see that the validation goes up, and you want to see that the loss goes down. Here it's going up. I would give it maybe sometimes a little bit more time. Sometimes it goes a little bit up. But you want to see at least maybe 4, 5, 6 epochs that the loss decreases. If you see that it does not increase, or it even increases, I would actually stop the training, because then it's usually that you have a learning rate that is too large or other issues. So, but yeah, here I saw, okay, it's training well. And then I saw, okay, well, what's going on now? 68, 66, 67, something's weird here. And somehow, I honestly almost wanted to stop it here, but I was busy with other things and I just let it continue training. it goes even down to 62. I didn't stare at it the whole time because it was like 25 minutes. I was doing something else in the meantime. And then I was quite surprised when I looked at the plot. I had actually this double descent phenomenon that I talked about in a previous lecture. So first of all, the loss went down and then went up again. And then with this double descent over the epoch, so the epoch-wise double descent, I saw it went down again. And then it stayed here. So you can also see the same thing for the training validation accuracy. It improves, then it comes worse, and then improves again. But overall, you can also see the huge degree of overfitting, 20%. That's I added already dropout, but it didn't help that much, and that's still overfitting. So one thing that might help is maybe adding more dropout, or also adding more data augmentation. So if you go here, instead of just random cropping, you could also do something with a color jitter and rotation and things like that. That might also help with the overfitting. So in practice, if you find overfitting like that. But yeah, I was a little bit under time pressure to get this code finished for the lecture, and it already took a long time, so I didn't want to rerun everything to reduce overfitting. Might be an interesting exercise if you're interested to try this out. Okay, so then I'm just looking at some results, so I visualize them. So notice here, I'm using this unnormalized function that I implemented somewhere in my helper function. I think I have it here. Let me see. Let me maybe double check where I implemented that. Let me scroll up. Unnormalized data set. Yep. Right here. So here, the unnormalizing is essentially undoing my normalization with this 0.5. So here I do the normalization, and here I'm undoing my normalization so that I can plot the images. So I'm essentially multiplying by the standard deviation and then adding the mean, and I do that for every channel. That's just a very compact way of writing this. You don't have to understand this in detail. It's just very efficient. I mean, I wanted to just write this in one line instead of writing too much code here. All right, so essentially this will unnormalize. So I have to provide the information that I used for normalizing. So I provide them the same way and just does the same thing as the normalizing, but inverse, like reversing it. All right, so then I give it also the class dictionary with the names so that in my plot here, my show examples plot, I can actually see the names, the predictions. You can see actually, and this looks cool. Here, it's funny, it actually, it gets dogs and cats wrong. So the predicted label is dog and the true label is a cat, which I think justifies the fact that so many people work on cats versus dog classifiers because it's actually a challenging problem. Okay. And then again, my confusion matrix here, just to look at what they get currently wrong. You can see it's kind of interesting. The dog versus cats is a category that is often, or most often, wrong in this data set. It's kind of funny. Also ship and airplane here, and frog and cat. Oh, frog and cat, I mean, they're not that similar, but okay. Yeah, so that is how AlexNet works. And it's essentially, overall, it's the same as Linet, except that we have no color channels and the network architecture is, of course, bigger. So if I scroll up again, it takes longer to train. And it's, yeah, you can see it's much bigger than our Linet before, which was just, smaller network. All right, that's it then for the lecture. I mean, let me just briefly go to this one because I have it. So here I trained another CNN, if you're interested, try to get better accuracy. But it's just a CNN with batch norm and leaky ReLU and dropout, trying to reduce the overfitting. You can see it was not that much better. It gets somewhat better accuracy. It trains only 30 minutes instead of 3 hours, which is also an improvement. Doesn't have this double descent, but it's still overfitting by a lot. It gets 100% training accuracy though, which is quite surprising. So, okay. Yeah, it's another network. It gets confuses a deer with an airplane. It's also interesting. Also, the cat versus dog is wrong here again. Here also cat versus dog. It's apparently a challenging category. All right, so that's it then for this lecture. In the next lecture, we will take more detailed look into different neural network architectures. I mean, these two, LINET and AlexNet, are really like beginner architectures. They are quite old, but they are more powerful architectures. And yeah, that's the topic of the next lecture.